Hello everyone, welcome back to Triad Travelogues. I'm Richard, and I am coming at you today from the outskirts of Shanghai, China. And I want to talk to you a little bit today about culture shock. Now, culture shock, I think a lot of people don't really understand what that means, like what culture shock actually is. You know, before I left for Nepal, I spent the better part of a year in Nepal, and it was my first experience outside of my home country, the United States of America. And you know, people talk, when you talk to people about what you're planning on doing, like, yeah, I'm planning on doing this sort of long-term travel in Asia, people say, oh, your culture shock is gonna be bad, you're gonna have culture shock. And I always sort of said to people, you know, I won't have any culture shock, you know, I'm rugged. I'm an adventurer, you know, I'm not afraid of anything. I don't have any attachments to anything, you know, to experience something like that. And you know, for the first few months, my first few months in Nepal, I didn't have anything resembling what I would consider to be like culture shock. Because I always thought that culture shock was like, you go to a new culture and then you're shocked. Oh, this culture is different than mine, and it's shocking. But that's not actually what culture shock is. Culture shock is a debilitating depression that consumes your entire existence as long as it's present in your travels. And I think most people don't understand that. Most people just think that culture shock is just when you go to another culture and you compare the cultures and say, whoa, I'm shocked. But the reality is that culture shock is actually, it feels very much like depression. And I don't think it really happens to people who go to a new culture for like a vacation for a few weeks. You know, I think you really have to, it has to, I mean, from my experience, it has to sort of happen in terms of long-term travel, because you know, you have to settle into a place and get past the sort of romanticism that exists. And I've talked about this in my other video, long-term travel versus short-term travel. You know, there is this period of time when everything is better and greater and grander than anything you've ever experienced before. It's sort of like falling in love with somebody, but you just fall in love with a country, or you fall in love with, you know, I don't know, a continent, you just fall in love with whatever the new experience is, and you don't really see it objectively. I mean, you never see it objectively, but you especially don't see it objectively in that first month or 2 months. You know, because you're in love with it, everything is new, it's a new experience, you know, and it's just all the sights and sounds and smells and people and the colors, and everything's just so different that you don't really look at it realistically, you know? Like if you go to I was a volunteer in Kathmandu, Nepal at an orphanage. And, you know, I was gonna be there for months and months and months. And when I first got there, I just, like I said, I was in love with the place, you know? I thought it was the greatest place in the world. Same thing with China. I'm in Shanghai, China right now. When I first got to China, it was the greatest place in the world. I loved it more than anything, you know? Now, I didn't experience the same kind of culture shock in China that I did in Nepal. And that's because I think I was hardened by then. I understood what I was dealing with, leaving my home country and going to another country for a long period of time. But in Nepal, those first few months were like nothing I've ever experienced in my life. And I just assumed that's what Nepal is like. That's what this whole experience is gonna be like. I wasn't thinking realistically. I wasn't thinking about when things settled down, when my emotions sort of leveled out, that I was gonna be stuck in a difficult place, in a difficult country, you know? And not to say that Nepal is particularly difficult for any reason other than that it was different than what I was used to. You know, I was used to the Western amenities, and I was used to having access to things. You know, I could access food and clean water, and I could go to the store and buy beer or whatever, you know, I could do those things back home. But in Nepal, everything was this long, drawn out, complicated process. Going to the grocery store, it was an all day event to go to the grocery store and get a jar of peanut butter, you know? Or some places don't have access to clean water, so you have to walk for miles to go and get like buckets of water that they say is clean. So it's different, you know? But culture shock really comes in after you level out, and after your emotions are much closer to how they were when you were at home, and you can start to sort of see the routineness of the life that you're living, the life that you're going to be living, that's when the culture shock kicks in. And it has really nothing to do with culture. It has more to do with being removed from things that are familiar and having to come to terms with the fact that, well, for me, having to come to terms with the fact that that removal was more or less permanent, or at least, at the very least, that it was going to exist for the entirety of the time that I was there at that orphanage, for the entirety of the time that I was there in that new country when I was in Nepal. So, you know, it's like that you start to miss things. And it's not even big things. You know, I never missed Texas or Maryland or the United States or even the people that I was there with, my family and friends. I didn't miss any of those things. I missed like smells and tastes. Like I missed, you know, I had this craving for donuts. I really wanted to eat donuts. And the donuts in Nepal just didn't cut it. You know, I wanted Dunkin' Donuts. And I never ate donuts when I was living in the States, but I just had, it was like a craving for, whoa, Jesus. It was like a craving for something that I couldn't have. And I think it was more about the fact that I couldn't have it than it was about the fact that I really desired it. You know, I wanted to eat donuts. I wanted to eat a specific kind of donut that I knew I wasn't gonna be able to get in Nepal. You know, during the autumn time, I wanted some pumpkin spice flavored coffee, and I couldn't get it. And you know, and when looking back and I think about it now, those things that I wanted were really associated with comfort and familiarity, you know, because the smells are much different and the tastes are much different in another country. Their holiday celebrations are different. The way that they look at the seasons is different. Even the seasons, they feel different in terms of the weather, just the atmosphere, you know. So that pumpkin spice coffee, I had come to associate with the autumn. That was inevitably gonna be a part of autumn. And then the first time it wasn't, the first time of my life, there were no pumpkin spice smells. There was no pumpkin spice coffee. There were not even any pumpkins that I can remember. Like, you know, the big orange pumpkins. There were no jack-o'-lanterns. It looked and felt different. And it's not, you don't look at it and experience it and say, oh, this is different than what I'm used to. It's more like a sort of panic that those things that you are used to, those things that you crave are no longer available to you and you can't have them. And it becomes an issue of control over your environment. And you realize that you don't have any control over your environment. You know, you don't have any control over anything that happens. So you're sort of at the whims of the wind. And I think that's what's the most scary about it. And eventually that sort of fear becomes a kind of complacency, and that complacency becomes depression. And it is a form of depression, you know? It's like, and it's hard to put it into words, especially because I don't really deal with depression and I've never had any kind of clinical issues like that. I've had issues, but never on the depressive side. And so for me, it was like, it was really the first time I had experienced that. And it feels like stagnation. It feels like being stuck in the middle of two things, you know, when you can't really move and you can't think and you just want to sleep all the time. And that's how depression has been described to me from people who actually did suffer from clinical forms of depression. Well, just from depression. And so I think I missed things, not because I wanted them, or even because I would have wanted them if I was in the United States, but because the fact that I couldn't have them meant that I was no longer in control. I didn't have that control anymore. And then you have to start thinking about, philosophically, what it really means to have control over anything. Do you really have control over your life? Regardless of where you're at, you could get into a car accident any day. You know, even if you're driving the car, you don't really have control of the car. You don't have control of the weather. You don't have control over how other people behave towards you or how they feel about you. And you never really have that control. And for me, I think the depression was more, well, the culture shock was more about having to redefine the things that I thought were absolute, having to reevaluate those things. You know, and I don't know if everybody else experiences it like that, but I certainly did. And I went to an internet cafe once, maybe my third month in Nepal, because I was so depressed and I just didn't understand it. You know, like I had saved up for 2 years to go and have this experience, and I was doing everything I always wanted to do, and I was having adventures left and right. Everything was exactly as I wanted it, and yet I wasn't happy. I felt stuck. And I went to an internet cafe. They got these shady internet cafes all over Nepal because most homes don't have internet connections. And I brought my laptop and I looked up culture shock. What is culture shock, you know? And it was at that moment that I realized this is what I'm suffering from. It is culture shock. And it isn't about like, oh, Nepali culture is so weird and I just can't deal with it, you know? It isn't about that. It's really about me. It's really about my sort of perception of the reality of the world that I live in. And it's being shaken and it's being changed by all the new sights and the new smells and the new things that are comfortable to other people, but they're not comfortable to me. You know, the like they have in Nepal, they have dasai. Probably not saying that right because I'm so bad at pronouncing anything that's not in English, but it's sort of a 2 week holiday, and it's the biggest holiday. It's the biggest holiday in Nepali culture, and you can tell when those people celebrate that it's something that's deep inside of them. You know, they've always celebrated, and they've always done the same sort of traditional things, and the colors are familiar to them. And so all those things that you associate with, like Christmas, you know, the smells and the colors and the sights and the songs and just the atmosphere, those things are the exact same as somebody in Nepal celebrating Dasai. Like, it's the same. But you can't really tap into that because it's just not your culture. You know, you can, like, I loved it. I enjoyed celebrating with them, but I really couldn't get into it. I mean, I never would have been able to get into it like they did because it wasn't inside of me. I was always going to be an outsider. And that's that feeling, again, it goes back to that sort of being in between two things, being stuck in the middle, where you really, you know, you're never gonna be able to get out of that place in the middle, you know? Stuck between Western and Eastern culture and my traditions and their traditions, and just being sort of an outsider. And then you question everything. You question your place in the world. And it's not something that goes away after you leave. I'm gonna do another video about reverse culture shock, what it's like to go back home, because it's a much different experience than the original form of culture shock. Now, I will say, for people who have looked this video up and they need some kind of comfort because they're in a similar situation that I was in, I can tell you that it does go away. The depressive part of culture shock, it goes away. You're never gonna be, I mean, I can only speak for myself, but I assume it's probably the same for most people. You're not ever gonna assimilate. I mean, maybe in 20 years, or I mean, I don't know, you know, I guess each person is different, but those things that are deep inside of you are always gonna be deep inside of you, you know? If you are a Westerner and you're from the States and you always celebrated Christmas the same way, and your family used the, like, certain kinds of wrapping paper and they made certain kinds of food for Christmas dinner or for Thanksgiving or whatever, those are always going to be in you, even if you don't really realize it. You can't ever really erase those things. And the same goes for whatever culture that you're in. You know, their traditions and their the things that are important to them, that hold significance to them, have depth that will never go away. You know, it's always gonna linger there. So, you know, in that respect, you just have to sort of accept that you're gonna be stuck between those things. You know, there's not really a lot you can do about it. Now, eventually the depression, at least for me, the depression went away. I was never completely 100% okay, but there were a lot of other things that I was going through, and you know, that's a subject for another video. That's the subject for a book, actually. I'm writing a book about my experience in Nepal. But yeah, culture shock is not pleasant. It feels like mental illness, and maybe it is sort of a form of mental illness, you know? I think a good substitute word would be cultural displacement, you know, because you've been, oh, wow. Look at this little puppy dog. Look at this little puppy. He's a little puppy, yeah. He's a little puppy. That is a really, really cute puppy.
He's a little puppy.
Anyway, geez, what was I saying? Oh yeah, cultural displacement. That's what it is. I'm gonna give it a name. Cultural depressive displacement disorder. We're gonna call it that, okay? And that's exactly what it sounds like. It's not culture shock, it's depression. You know, and it's circumstantial depression, sure, but it will knock you off your ass if you're not careful, you know? And I think a big part of getting over it is just accepting things as they are. And I have a hard time doing that. I'm in China right now, and you know, I didn't experience the same sort of culture shock. The culture is totally different, but I have access to a lot more things here than I did in Nepal. Plus, my family is here. I met my wife here. I had a daughter here. I have friends here. I'm working here, you know, I'm never gonna assimilate into Chinese culture. Chinese culture, a lot of aspects of Chinese culture really get on my nerves. And I've done videos about that, you know, but it's, you know, that sort of level of depressive culture shock, it was circumstantial, and it really was based on a lot of different emotions that I had in me, and just things that I was going through. You know, and I think anybody who embarks on long-term travel, anyone who's like, you know, past their mid-20s and has decided to just drop everything and go and travel the world, there's something going on up here, you know? Something has happened to that person. They've transformed in some way. And I would guess that most of those people have been broken in a lot of different ways, and they're trying to unbreak themselves, or they're trying to find a new life. You know, the travelers that I've met on during my adventures, pretty much anybody who's left their home country to explore has had a past. They've had difficulties, whether it be like, you know, substance abuse, drug addiction, relationship issues, they failed at their careers, or, you know, whatever the case, they had some kind of debilitating mental illness. You know, it's more often than not when you meet these long-term travelers, they have similar stories if they're willing to share those with you. And so, I lost my train of thought. I hate it when that happens. I did a good like 19 minutes and then I just lost my train of thought. Anyway, yeah, you know, it's a circumstantial thing for the most part. And I don't really believe that if you go to a new culture just for a week or 2 weeks that you're gonna experience any culture shock, especially if you're staying in a 4-star hotel and you're being guided around by some like westernized tour guide. So you really want to experience that culture shock, you gotta go move to another culture, you know? And I guess it's probably different for different people. But I want to give you a little bit of a hope, okay? I'm gonna end this video because I gotta go work. But I want to give you some hope. The wind is gonna mess my video up. some issues with the audio quality of some of these videos. And it's God's fault. It's the wind's fault. It's not mine. It's not my fault. I'm going to run over here to this building and I'm going to end the video right here. Do it right here. Okay. Yeah, I want to give you some hope, okay? It will get better. The most important thing for you to do if you are suffering from culture shock right now is just chill out and accept everything as it is. Don't put any expectations on anybody. Don't put any expectations on anything or anybody. Don't put, you know, just chill out, you know, relax, calm down, try and enjoy it. It's that's what travel is all about, you know. Don't worry too much about what you're going to get out of it. You always have time later to stop and to reflect on what you've experienced. You know, you always have time later on to you know, what did I get from it? You know, how did this benefit me? You can always look at it later and figure all that stuff out. But for now, just enjoy it. Just try and relax. You know, acceptance is the key. All right, I gotta go. Gotta go work. Gotta go work. Even world travelers have to work, unless they're super wealthy, and I'm not. So, thanks for watching Triad Travelogues. I'm Richard. Please, if you like this video, subscribe to my channel. Give the video a big thumbs up and maybe leave a nice comment. I'll see you later.